Let me start with a quick introduction. Good morning again, everyone. My name is Varun Malik. I'm the CEO of Consolidon. Consolidon is a new age consulting firm. New age in that we've taken a very, very different approach to how to grow a consulting firm. So what a traditional consulting firm would do would go ahead and hire consultants. They take a few years to build their delivery capabilities. In our model, what we did instead is we went to boutique consulting firms and asked them if they want to collaborate with us, become our delivery teams. So we do the business development, the client understanding, the proposal, etc., along with the boutique firm, and the boutique firm actually comes in to deliver. With that model, we've till 2019, we had more than 500 consultants. So we set up in 2017. So over a 3-year period, we had more than 500 consultants to choose from for projects. We delivered more than 200 consulting projects in the two and a half year period. We feel that it's a much more scalable model and a more new age model for consulting firms. We now have about 5,000 consultants to choose from. And we're really, really looking forward to, of course, 2021. This discussion today is a part of a web summit called Connected Insights. Connected Insights has been organized by, we have about 300 consulting firms that we collaborate with quite closely. So it's been put together by about 70 of those firms, right? Including Erewhon, right? So 70 of the boutique consulting firms and consulting firms in our ecosystem are doing this summit called Connected Insights. It goes over a 7-day period, and it has more than 50 webinars and panel discussions and 6 workshops in the evening. Very quickly before we begin, a couple of housekeeping things. We've made all of you panelists rather than attendees. And the reason for that is because we want you to interact during the discussion, ask questions, share ideas, et cetera, right? But what that also means is that there is the danger of you being on unmute and disrupting a bit of the session. So just remain to stay muted during the session. You can use the raise hands feature on Zoom, or you can just wave to us if your video is on, and we'll stop and we'll pause and ask you what your comment is or what your question is. In the chat, you can also leave your questions. Perhaps I can ask people to, in the chat, also just do a quick introduction of themselves, maybe leave their LinkedIn profile so that we can get to know who's here, as well as perhaps you can network and connect with each other. But in the chat, please look out for some giveaways. So around at the 30-minute mark, we'll be doing our first giveaway, which is, the 6 workshops that, there are only 5 left. So for the 5 workshops that are still left in this summit, these are paid workshops, $299 for 3-hour workshops. We're giving away 3 invites to these workshops for free. All you have to do is fill up a short form. So look out for that form. And around the 75-minute mark, this is a 90-minute workshop. So around the 75-minute mark, what we'll do is also invite you to be speakers in future editions of Connected Insights. This is the first edition of Connected Insights. So for future editions of Connected Insights, we've put a short form which you can complete if you want to be a speaker. So that's it from me. Rajiv and I have collaborated for the last 3 years. Erewhon was one of the very early entrants into our ecosystem. And we really appreciate all the support from you, Rajiv, over the last 3 years. And I'm really, really looking forward to this session. I love hearing your talks, and I'm looking forward to this one. Thank you, Rajiv. Over to you.
Thank you, Varun. Good to meet all of you, and it's also really good to know that I already know a couple of you. I'm sure we can build on wherever we left off together. And I hope there is more water under the bridge mutually for more value to have been added in any case, mutually. So let's plunge into some of the conversations. Essentially, as one of you said, the big challenge, I mean, all of us as organizations, every 2 years, most organizations come up with a renewed strategy. The whole objective is to fuel new directions, new growth. And the aspiration is, you know, naturally, at the starting point, the aim is to make it happen with a speed and to create impact. But as we all know, there are huge amount of challenges which stand in the way of making it happen. Creating it and executing it can be completely different, and really that's where the challenges are going to be. So I'm going to share with you some of our insights into what does it take to transform the pace and impact of a new strategy. A new strategy will pose new challenges. And what does it take to actually crack those challenges and increase the pace and impact is really the question we are dealing with today. And as you can see, we love the idea of the physics as a metaphor. So it's all about orbit shifting and gravity which stands in the way of it. So a new strategy is propelling a new direction, but there is gravity, which is always sitting there, which the organization has gathered over the period, and which will resist that the new. So how does one overcome that? And all the insights I'm going to share with you today are drawn from our work around orbit shifting innovation, with which we work with creating and executing new strategies. And this orbit shifting innovation is fundamentally about transformative impact. What does it take to conceive and create it? And the insights that I'll be sharing with you are drawn from a very fascinating spectrum of experiences across industries, across markets, literally Asia, Europe, and US. It's a very fascinating mix which has brought to us all these amazing insights which have come together in some form here. So, a map that I love that I found many years ago, which I can't help but start with. So guys, we will try and make it as interactive as possible. So keep engaged with me. I'd be very curious to know your first reaction to a map like this. Your first reactions? Guys, spontaneous reactions would be welcome. Yes, by, please.
Upside down, almost?
Yeah. Not really almost. It is. Yeah, the others. Your first reactions? By the way, if you had this map on a piece of paper in front of you, what would have been your instinctive reaction?
It's a different point of view.
Turn it around.
Naturally, I mean, after all, we are used to looking at the map in a particular way. Instinctively, most people just turn it around. Actually, the reason I'm sharing this map with you, I found it many years ago, and it has stuck with me all this time as a great metaphor of what it really brings alive is how maps were designed to be information. But over a period of time, when you've seen a map in one way for a long time, it becomes a mindset. There really is one way of looking at the map. Now you notice somebody just accidentally happened to draw it the other way. Incidentally, the world would look like this if you were kind of standing on the South Pole. So it doesn't have to be, but it becomes the other way. If you notice, when I point this out, what it is pointing to is how legacy mindsets get created. You know, the map is one evidence, but really this happens at a much larger scale in an organization. When over a period, people get conditioned into legacy mindsets. I mean, we evolve ways of working, and over a period of time, these ways become legacy, and legacies create a lock-in. In this sense, then we start approaching a new challenge in the old way. And amazingly, how this happens so unknowingly, but over a period that it starts to happen within the industry and across industries. You know, you might think, you know, but for legacy mindsets to happen, it must take decades or even years. Believe me, it can happen in months. Just to illustrate this, you'd be very interested to know a very fascinating experiment was conducted once, where groups of senior managers from bright people from bright organizations, don't mistake their intelligence, they were put into two different rooms. You know, and they were told about this strange disease called chromosynthosis. By the way, there's no such disease. You know, they were gathered into these two rooms and told that, you know, just like people who have color blindness can't see some colors, people who have chromosynthosis can't hear some sounds. Now, they were told about chromosynthosis. So over 2 hours, they were told about the symptoms, the causes, the consequences of chromosynthosis. After having been sensitized so deeply, they were all given a hearing test. They were all given a hearing test. And what do you think they found? Guys, how many people had chromosynthosis? What do you think they found? Your first guess is?
Zero.
Well, there's somebody who's very hopeful. You know, amazingly enough, almost all people had chromosynthosis. Because by now, they had become so sensitized that they all believed they couldn't hear some things. But by the way, group A had been told, in reality, most of us have it. You know, so they were not surprised. They expected to have it. But group B had been told that in reality, you know, very few people have it. But both of these teams have groups had also been told now that there is chromosynthosis and there is no cure. So you can imagine, right? Group A, who had been told that a majority has it, they had been told everybody has it and there's no cure. Now, group B had been told the minority has it and you can improve on your own. When they were tested after a few months, group A had deteriorated further. There's no cure. Oh my God, I'm in those few without any cure. Having chromosynthosis, a lot of them had deteriorated further, but group B had shown an improvement after 2 months. Amazing, isn't it? What it demonstrates to you is how easy it is to condition a group of people. A group of bright people were conditioned in a matter of 2 hours and they started seeing things they believed. By this form of chromosynthosis, while this is an experiment, it happens in real life all the time. You notice over a period of time, how do legacies get built? People start presenting assumptions and facts, assumptions and beliefs as facts. And you must have heard this, right? Our industry is like this. I've heard it all the time, huh? That insurance industry is a push business. By the way, across companies, this is supposed to be the sacred truth. Nobody dare question it. Amazing. I am not sure who created this belief, but everybody believes it by now. And you know, when we are working with media houses, news media especially, I'm sure you must have seen, they all believe by now, negative news is news. Positive news is not even news. People don't watch positive news. And who is their customer? 30 plus male. They don't believe in women here are interested in news. Youth, definitely not. Amazing. Huh? These are all legacy mindsets, which frees them into one way of thinking. And over a period of time, these are assumptions which become facts. And then we are told this industry is like this. It's almost they are letting the industry define them rather than them defining the industry. But this is how legacies get created and we start deciding how we approach the future. And the biggest impact of legacy really happens on a new strategy. It becomes the gravity, so really a new strategy therefore settles into what the legacy mindsets will allow. And the moment there is a battle against them, you can imagine, right? Gravity is much stronger. You throw the ball and it comes right back. I'm sure all of you have lived through multiple of these struggles with these kind of legacy mindsets. And especially, you know, just to give you an example, we were involved in a major project with the global multinational, which was into fast moving consumer goods, an FMCG. So as a part of the new strategy, one area was to create a breakthrough or to create completely new growth in the category of laundry. Now they're into fast moving consumer goods. One area was laundry. One focus area was to make a big leap in that space. They were all very deeply sensing that the next disruption here is going to happen. Nothing has happened in the last few years. And they wanted to lead it. That was the intent of strategy. Now, you notice, what is the usual way of approaching execution of a strategy? The next challenge was, okay, so we have to get new product ideas. So how do we get ideas? Classical innovations equal to ideation. So get the whole world to share ideas. The belief being that, you know, ideas are simmering all there. We just have to capture them. So they had actually asked all, this is a global organization, they had asked all their country teams to come up with ideas. By now they had 4,000 ideas. But really speaking, when they were talking to us, you know, they didn't find anything amazingly different. There was no breakthrough in them. Now think about it, guys, this is what legacy can do. Sometimes across the world, across the diverse cultures even, the legacy of an industry or of an organization can bind everybody into a box. Very unknowingly, and by now, people are almost unconsciously living within that box. So when we say think out of the box, that's easy to say, but actually the real challenge is out of box. And how does one even find that box? So in this case, we invited these people saying, you know, you have 4,000 ideas, wonderful, share those ideas with us and we'll map the boxes. So the starting point is not really thinking out of the box, but finding the boxes. In this case, you know, as we dug deeper to find the boundaries, some boundaries began to emerge. Now, Jaja, again, Jaja, just humor me a little, guys. Unmute yourself and engage with me for a quick minute. So when you ask yourself, what is the purpose of laundry? What is the purpose of laundry? What would be your spontaneous reaction? What is the purpose of laundry, guys? What would be the most spontaneous response to that?
Cleaning, freshness.
Yeah. Cleaning, freshness. So you notice the moment you say cleaning, as we were going through the ideas, one boundary that emerged very quickly was associated with this. So when you say cleaning, let me just pause and ask you to frame the idea. Think about it. So laundry is a post-dirt intervention. So the moment I say cleaning means post-dirt intervention, I'm sure a blind spot opens up immediately, doesn't it? A new direction of thought emerges. Post-dirt. Yes. Well, what about pre-dirt? What about preventing dirt? A new question emerged, a new direction emerged, which led to a flurry of possibilities, which were very, very different from what they had thought about earlier. We had not done any magic. We just uncovered the box. By the way, the other box, which was very closely adjacent to this box, was that laundry equals cleaning. But that means the purpose of laundry is to remove. What could it add? Pausing, add? Well, obviously no dirt, but what else? As it went further, it could add health. That led to another flurry of possibilities, completely different. And you must have seen that fabric today is advertising anti-UV. Couldn't that come from the conditioner? You know, it just changed the question fundamentally. But really, you notice the starting point was ideation was just not enough. By the way, this organization has invested millions of dollars world over in cleaning technologies by now. So what do you think all the ideas around the world were focused on? They were all about removing dirt. They were all about cleaning faster, better, cheaper. So all multiple, but 4,000 ideas. People had tried. There was no shortage of intent or effort. But unconsciously, these boundaries had blocked them. So you notice how what legacy mindsets do. And you know, we say that innovation can be done. All you need is diversity of cultures. But take a look. Even diverse cultures around the world were all stuck in one boundary. But that's not difficult to see when the organizations, industries, boundaries are far bigger. They actually capture everybody everywhere. So this is, I hope, illustrating to you that just simply ideation and asking people for ideas is not going to be enough. In fact, we've seen it repeatedly yield very minimal. Because the assumption we are making is it will be enough to break through the boundaries. It just isn't. So that's really one. Innovation is equal to ideation is not enough. It's about finding and then breaking through the mental model boundaries deliberately. So what happens? A new strategy poses new challenges, but they get approached with the old mindset. I mean, it's like a new idea entering an old pipe. You can imagine, right, and what happens then? The challenge gets adjusted to suit the old pipe. The pipe doesn't change to match the challenge very often. That is, I'm sure all of you must have experienced that repeatedly. that when faced with a new idea which sounds beyond what we know, most people's reaction is to how to adjust the idea to suit what they know rather than to do what more needs to be done to match up to the new idea. And these are the challenges that we'll all face. And one challenge which a new strategy always proposes is, you know, new growth, new markets. That's inevitably always a part of most strategies. So, but here again, a gravity comes in. What is the approach towards winning in a new market or new category? We end up replicating the what we know as opposed to creating. I'm sure you must have seen most multinationals are very guilty of this. When we enter a new market, we replicate the success model that we've created earlier. By the way, guys, have you seen this happen? Replicating a winning strategy from the old market in a new market. I'm sure you must have experienced this, all of you. Have you?
Yeah, always.
So sorry, who said that? Please expand.
Yeah, this is Utmesh. Rajiv, hi.
Hi.
So I think that's a very common thing that companies do, because you're looking for a, you know, sort of a quick wins.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you want to just, you know, carry the success story because you have rare successes. So you want to carry it as far as you can. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you just, first thing you think of is replicating, you know, this product has worked in this market, so launch it in the other markets, or this business model worked here, so let's take it to other markets. So I think they do that till they find something else. But I think that's a very common, easy, lazy way approach, you know.
Mm-hmm. And then you notice what it does is it actually very often minimizes the potential of that new market. I mean, this happens repeatedly, that we end up working the previous success model forward as opposed to working market back. So you notice the market back may not be a change in product. It could be a change in customers, channel engagement. But that becomes a real challenge. And I'm sure all of you are, you know, there's one example we came across in our work with a company which was an amazing example of this. I mean, of how replication caused 7 years of pain. You know, Titan is one of the very successful watch brands in India. The next growth, they were very successful in watches. The next growth, well, what about jewelry? It was adjacent in the market. This was literally an adjacency in terms of lifestyle. So they went into jewelry. But amazingly, they replicated the watch model in jewelry. You know, that was very successful. And what was this model? International stores, great stores, international designs is equal to success. That had worked brilliantly for watches. That was replicated for jewelry. And it failed miserably. Year on year. It was 7 years of bleeding, really, till the fundamental question in hindsight, very obvious, was asked, how is the jewelry customer different? You can imagine, right? A jewelry customer is fundamentally different. It's more of a trust buyer. There are family jewelers. It just changed the whole question. And that is when the reinvention started. They went from replicate to create after 7 years, but then have subsequently, credit to them, have made it an amazing success. But look at it. It took 7 years. And it's not as if every year reviews weren't happening. What do you think happens in a review? Oh, the idea was good, but the execution was bad. Let's execute it even better. Without asking ourselves the most fundamental question. And incidentally, this is more a research that I'm sharing with you. We were at the leading edge of this with another company, which where something similar had happened. This was when New York Life Insurance, when they started in India, it became the Max New York Life. And imagine, like, New York Life has 150 years of successful experience in selling insurance. When they came to India, the assumption is we know it all. We just have to teach those Indians how to sell. So that's what happened. They launched with Max New York Life. Then frustration that the sales model, that the agency model was not working. And the classical reactions that we were hearing across the country were, this is, you know, the classical reaction that all of you must have heard, this market is different. You know, it doesn't work here. But as a result, it was bleeding. So the challenge was here. Now, how do we respond to a challenge like this? Either we can settle at the lowest common denominator. To make this market entry into India work, something had to be questioned. The starting point was break the boundary. Here, the leadership team, the classical boundary is stick to the global way or succeed in India. You know, come on, it doesn't work. We'll create something in India. Naturally, global organization was resisting it. What it led to was a very unique approach, that unique model which works in India and leverages global experience. But most importantly, not wait for mandates, but take the mandate. Not seeking empowerment, but acting empowered. But that's another challenge when you are not 150-year-old, you're a new company. How does one challenge such an established model? But in this case, they questioned it, challenged it, and innovated on the model. In fact, up to the point of involving the New York life, I remember that conversation when we had innovated on the model in India, the gentleman, we had invited the team from New York life to come and co-create it with us. Because we naturally wanted the stakeholders to co-own it. Now, in the conversation, what these two gentlemen from New York said was, you know, to be honest, I had come here to fight. I thought the Indians are going to tell me it's not going to work here and dump this. But you guys have innovated on the model. That's brilliant. In fact, it's taken it to the next level. And amazingly enough, it went to the next level because it challenged other fundamental elements, like how do you engage with agents, which was challenging the basic sales model, the cultural model of sales managers. And finally, it led to success. And this, I must say, one of you was raising this question right in the beginning as an expectation. What emerged as a pathway evolved. And to my mind, think about it, evolution is an essential part of creating success. What we start with was a starting idea, which took a couple of years to evolve into a success model and went to two or three versions. And finally, the successful model achieved an amazing impact. The New York Life agent in India became three times as productive as the industry average. And it 3x the growth in India. But and by the way, this is still a reference point across the country even today in terms of what a new benchmark it created. And most interestingly, it became a reference point for New York Life worldwide. But the starting point again was to challenge those boundaries and not assume they know it, therefore it can't be questioned, and to build on it. But more importantly, to build on the industry's models on how the industry was working in India. So challenging those boundaries led to success. But think about it, this replication, where does it begin? It starts with customer engagement being done with legacy mindsets. In fact, the way we view customers is with a legacy mindset. After some time, most of the experienced companies, they know their customers. So even when they go into market research, guys, just humor me a little. This is a very interesting question, which I couldn't help ask you. So what do you think? What do these things have in common, by the way? First reactions. What do these things have in common?
The portable devices.
No. All of these models have become obsolete somewhere.
True. Anything else they have in common? Well, actually, no consumer ever directly asked for them. They were all latent needs. I mean, for example, nobody asked for a sugar substitute, right? It was a latent need sitting with the people who were suffering from sugar problems. Or for a Walkman, for that matter. No, nobody asked for a Walkman. But really, think about it. The idea of the need to listen to music privately actually always existed. It's just that somebody picked it up. And the biggest challenge in customer engagement is to get to the latent needs, which is really to decode it. Is go beyond what people are saying to what they think but do not say, what they feel but do not share. Well, that is the absolute highest value a customer engagement can reach. Where does it stay usually? Usually we end up staying very superficially. And in fact, customer engagement with a legacy mindset, what does it do? We go to the market with a validation mindset. So we already have a hypothesis. And then naturally, when you enter a new market with a validation mindset, what will you find? Believe me, you will find confirmation. Because we get answers to the questions we asked. And we will never find the answers to the questions we never asked. And in this case, another very interesting experiment we conducted once was with a company which was trying to get new products in the space of wellness. You know, so by the way, two teams were created. One team was into services associated with wellness. Another team was in products. And they went out into the market. Look at how they validated. The team that was into products, when they were talking to customers, they naturally first asked the customer the basics and then went on to say, went on to explore for opportunities. The same thing was done by the services team. Amazingly, when they both came back at the end of 2 days, the products team came back with new product opportunities. The service team came back with service opportunities. And how come? Because the product team had asked, you know, so are you interested in wellness? Yes. So if we gave you this product which could do this for you, would you be interested? The customer said yes. The service team said, you know, if we could give you this service in the neighborhood which could do all this for you, would you be interested? Naturally, the customer said yes. Because what the customer says yes to at that point in time, what he buys in any case fundamentally different. But you notice how they both just simply validated their own hypothesis, came back, convinced they had an idea. Product team with a product proposition, well, service team with a service proposition. And this happens repeatedly. The starting point, the existing mental model decides the hypothesis which we validate. So by the way, the strategy that we are talking about is going to face boundaries, or where is it going to face gravity? In terms of business gravity and cultural gravity. Business gravity comes from how we engage with customers and how we engage with the channel. So basically, where is the old pipe? The old pipe is way of approaching customers, and who the customers are has gotten fixed. And how we engage with the channel has gotten fixed. Unlocking that and genuinely rediscovering that becomes the challenge. And cultural mental models, of course, are even deeper. So what are these? We've talked about the business ones, so let's also talk about the cultural ones. I've talked to you about the business mental models regarding customer and challenge, channel. What about the cultural ones? Solving for the new challenges posed by the strategy, what does legacy culture do? You know, we get into what we call repair versus redesign. Now think about it. Most people end up, the default setting is repair. It's not redesign. Whereas very often the strategy is calling for redesign and not just repair. But the default setting is repair. And how does it shape up? You know, think about it. How do people engage with challenges? Now there could be, you know, the challenge posed by the new strategy, or the new challenges coming up are, now that the way you react to a new challenge could be incrementally or in a breakthrough way. So do you want an incremental improvement or a quantum impact? Is it the way we are engaging with the new challenge is with a problem mindset or an opportunity mindset? Problem mindset is reactive, proactive mindset is opportunity. So how are we engaging with the new challenges? Incrementally or quantum, problem-led or opportunity-led? And you notice these four spaces open up. So how are we engaging the challenge in a problem-fixing mindset or in a transformative solution mindset? Continuous improvement or proactively? By the way, these are the four zones in which we operate at any one point in time. And I'm sure you must have noticed that at least we have, that whenever we work with organizations across the world and you ask them, so where are we and where do we need to be? The day-to-day managing of the business traps us into problem fixing and a little bit of improvement. But transformative solution and proactive leaps remain, you know, wishful thinking, which never really happens. So the trouble is a new strategy poses challenges which will call for completely new approaches. But how do we end up approaching it? We end up approaching an orbit-shifting challenge in an orbit-maintaining way. And we end up fixing. You know, you must have seen it. You know, very, very recently, I was involved with a firm which has gone into a 3xing strategy, growth strategy. And everybody was asked to come up with how will they do it. Believe me, everybody had immediately done a survey, identified problems, and had begun fixing within a matter of weeks. Now, even fixing all of these problems will lead to a 10% growth for get to 2x. So the starting point in itself becomes gravity, where we are approaching this question. To share with you, you know, we were into a very interesting project with IFF, this is International Flavors and Fragrances. They provide the flavors and fragrances to large firms like Unilever, P&G, Colgate, Palmolive, etc. So B2B. Now, the new aspiration, the new strategy was to fuel a 3x growth. And the one challenge there was that they had to triple their success rate of winning new briefs. Now, at present, they were winning only one in every six briefs. The challenge was they had to win one in every two. Now, so immediate reaction. So how do we do it? Problem fixing. I remember that they immediately sent out a survey form, got feedback from all their customers, and started fixing core quality issues, started fixing R&D apparatus issues, started looking at, you know, our problem is the way we pitch to customers. So basically, these problems got identified and they started instantly fixing them. The question became fault. What is the boundary here? Do we even know what problem we need to solve? Even solving for this is not going to take us there. So by and just holding them, going from repair to redesign, it led to a new question. So what are customers actually seeking? Now, by the way, in this world, what happens is a customer who wants a new fragrance, say in a soap or a shampoo, whatever, they identify the fragrance, and then they have an empaneled group of four or five suppliers like IFF, whom this is pitched to, saying, you know, we need this, and everybody submits their fragrance, and then they choose one. This was the process. But the question was, you know, it's not about how we are responding to briefs, but what is fundamentally going wrong? By the way, when they got this feedback from all their customers, the customer feedback was all good. Customers were happy, actually. And yet, they were winning one brief out of six. So we urged them to actually pause completely and go and have a first-hand inside dialogue with customers. Not with a validate, but with a discovery mindset. And also, who do we talk to on the customer's end? Not the purchase manager, but the strategic marketing head on the other side, the product lead, the brand lead on the other side, and inquire not about what we are doing with them, and try and discover what are their challenges, and therefore, what part can you play in those challenges? You know, but what they discovered was that the client's biggest challenges was, naturally, as all of you can understand, differentiation and growth. How do we differentiate was the prime question. And what struck them very forcefully was they were seeking differentiation, but we as IFF are not even solving for differentiation. We are solving for the brief. Maybe we have a different view on differentiation. And the client was actually instinctively choosing that product which would help him differentiate. So that actually broke through the boundary fundamentally. The challenge became, how do we provide a differentiating solution to the customer? Not merely live up to his brief. Go beyond the brief. Now, what did that mean? It means a new capability. The new capability was getting end consumer insight, which this team had never engaged with. Like, they were depending upon customers who should be knowing it. So the making this shift from that point onwards, they decided that every brief, they'll go back with two outcomes. One, which is pure to the brief as the marketing guy gave them. The second is what we believe will enable you to differentiate with your end user. So two outcomes for every brief, not one. Believe me, this change actually led them to not 3x, but 4x their winning rate. In fact, over the next 2 years, they became the prime partners for quite a few organizations, wherein the default setting became that if you are doing something new, first talk to IFF. If that doesn't work, then we'll put it out. Amazingly, the The whole open brief system in itself, some companies gave up and started partnering them. That's a dream place for any supplier to be in, where he becomes truly a co-creation partner. But the redesign question started there, right? To rethink it completely, what are customers seeking that we don't understand? To rediscover the customer's needs and challenges and then work back from there, as opposed to starting to fix quality problems, wherein it's a design question. It's not a quality problem, perhaps. So the challenge, very often we find, more often than not, people start to redesign. They start with repair. To give you another very interesting example, which brings alive the challenge of repair versus redesign very beautifully. Another global FMCG, they are into personal care products. So the question was, you know, by the way, as a part of their sustainability strategy, they had decided that we must reduce the water impact. Water is becoming a stress product. So one challenge was in the soaps and shampoos areas, as their global brand director was telling me, that the challenge is our products take up a lot of water in consumption. We need to reduce that. So the strategic question was to reduce impact on water. And I was talking to him, so how much should we reduce? So what are you aiming for? He said, well, 20-30% reduction would be good. Now that sounded big to them. But to my mind, as I was sharing with him, I said, you know, Michael, it doesn't sound like an orbit shifting question. It sounds like orbit maintaining. Because actually, imagine a team working to reduce the water impact by 20%. What will they do? How will they think? Their approach is repair, right? So pre-shampoo, during shampoo, post-shampoo, map the process. Say, okay, what can we change pre-shampoo to reduce 3%, during shampoo 5%, post-shampoo another 4%. We've done it. We're close to 20%. This is the classical incremental thinking that takes over, right? The trouble, and so the question became, if we want to create a transformative impact, let's start with a transformative challenge. How do we not fix the problem, eliminate the problem? And the challenge became, what about the next product range of personal care without water? That actually changed the starting point. Believe me, the team got energized the way it had never done before. And the next 4 months, we had a portfolio of possibilities. But the energy really came from recrafting the challenge in itself and not living with problem fixing, but a proactive leap and a transformative solution, which would eliminate the problem fundamentally. So I'm hoping that this is painting to you where the biggest challenge by far is, how we end up starting with a problem fixing mindset. In fact, you notice we start with problems, not with opportunities. The starting point is fixing the problem, not identifying the new opportunity completely. So this is the second big challenge of where gravity really comes in the way amazingly. And what happens is orbit shifting aspiration, but orbit maintaining mindsets. You can imagine, right? It sounds great, but we will do what we are comfortable with. By the way, this is unconscious. It's not as if it's deliberate, but that people are doing their best. Their best within what they know. Those are the blind spots in approaching. And so guys, actually, inviting you to quickly reflect, all of you. You must have seen, right, when companies, you must have experienced this, when people are attempting a new strategy or trying to execute a new strategy. Where have you seen people end up in these four zones? Where do people end up being, and where do they need to be? I've shared with you my experiences. Would love to hear yours. In these four zones, where do people end up being? What have you experienced? Please do share, inviting you to reflect and share.
Yeah, I have seen most of the times continuous improvement is what, you know, people end up doing, because that's what the comfort level is. You know where you are, the context is known, the markets are known, or whatever solution space is known. So I think that incremental approach is what people are comfortable. And I think the whole mechanism, you know, R&Ds and the product marketing, market, sales, everybody's tuned towards that. I think this proactive leaps are for, you know, sort of visioning exercises, which remain on the PowerPoints most of the times to show the management or to talk in the press conferences or demonstrate prototypes. Yeah. Transformative solutions are difficult. I mean, people use terms like churning the ocean, you know, let's not do this. Let's get the low hanging fruits. And then, you know, you quickly move down to continuous improvement. And I think the problem fixing is something that is you know, that happens more of a external trigger, like, you know, either the market or the competition tells you that there is a problem, and then you start to, you know, sort of fix the leaks. So I think that's probably what the firefighting happens in that box. But the day-to-day life is about continuous improvement, you know?
No, actually, you are, Vaibhav?
Unmesh.
Yeah, just give me your name.
Unmesh.
Unmesh, actually, you notice what happens is in the bottom two, the process, the product, the model is a given. All we have to do is improve or fix it. Whereas the challenge when you move on to the top is to question the process in itself. Whereas so the comfort really comes from the process is known, how do we improve it or fix it? Whereas when you move into the top two, we have to redesign the very process, actually rethink it, reimagine it. And as we are talking about this, all of you, I'm sure, have experienced that, you know, with new technology like digital, everybody, by the way, the whole industry is talking digital these days. And amazingly, you must have seen, I don't know if you are familiar, but more than 85% of the digital initiatives around the world have failed. And you notice why? Because we are attempting completely new technology with the old mindset and actually ending up fixing the existing process as opposed to redesigning it. I'm sure you must have seen a lot of digital initiatives are going into fixing the current process, improving it or fixing it as opposed to redesigning it. So I'm just expanding on what you were saying, Unmesh. So the others, please, would love your experiences.
See, I am Atul, and in fact, for someone having gone through, this training program or this program 15 years back, I have constantly, in fact, ensured that how do you move into a new assignment, and these incremental gains are something that actually make you get into an assignment so fast. But the real jump is where, in fact, this you realize what is the quantum jump possibly you need to be looking for, or which is the best, in fact, within that industry, the company that you would like to catch up. So I can't claim myself or, in fact, to be like in that quantum jump sort of thing, but it has individually and personally, as an individual, it has helped me every time. And my progress in last 15 years also, I think I've shared with you and the rest of those colleagues that, in fact, I interacted with Irvon. Also, this is the 4S model is something that has changed my life. I've reached here. And to answer your question, largely, in fact, it has always been, even people do not reach up to these proactive and reactive sorts of approaches. There are times when somebody, in fact, takes those initiative and manages that or that 10-15% sort of a incremental gain. But if you, in fact, go through this model, this 4S model, in fact, and also start thinking in terms of doing it this differently or identifying what is it that you need to catch up to, the gains or in fact what you achieve is far, far more, much more than incremental.
I just thought
I'll share my personal experience.
Thank you, Atul. That's a great reflection and an input. So guys, also to share with you, so far I've given you a very strategic process example, also to give you an operational one, that we were actually working with the IBIS group of hotels. And the challenge was to reduce the cost of construction. Naturally, right, they are a low-cost hotel, so the challenge is to reduce cost. And so the classical, again, the starting point was 15% reduction. You notice that's unfortunately how a lot of thinking begins. And the other repair question is, okay, we'll do it one step at a time. I'm sure you heard that discussion too. One step at a time. But the strategy expects a leap. It doesn't expect one step at a time. It expects a leapfrog. So in this case, the challenge became, how do you reduce it to half? So they took on that challenge and then became, how do we transform construction processes, construction technologies? And believe me, they've reduced it by 40%. And the first hotels have already been constructed without compromising customer experience. So, but again, the starting point was, let's take on a redesign challenge, and you don't start with the current and saying all the cost centers, how do you reduce 5%, 10%? We have to do it in 50%. Now, how do we design it? So it became a redesign challenge, new technologies, new processes, construction process and technology, which has led to finally a 40% reduction. So this is again, and of course the other critical one, which by this one gravity is repaired versus redesigned, but the other biggest gravity, which all of you must have lived through, is how people engage with new problems and challenges. I mean, finally, when they are posed with a new strategy, it sounds great on a piece of paper, but the assumption is somebody else will do it, right? So how do people engage with that? So this is a very interesting model which brings alive to you how people engage with a new challenge or a new problem. If you notice, one axis is alignment and the other is initiative. So you must see the bar right in the middle is participate. So what's a participative response to a new problem or a challenge? So tell me what to do and I'll do it. Right? So, okay, strategy is fine, but tell me what am I supposed to do? So here are people waiting for a script. So they are not the solution finders. They say, you find the solution and tell me what to do. But then they execute it very well. But even below that is passive. By the way, guys, this is a very interesting episode and experience over the years. When these new strategies get announced at the end of 2 years, how do you think most people down the line react to them? Guys, first reaction, what is their first reaction? Belief or disbelief?
Nahin chalega, Dex.
Nahin chalega, won't work. Yeah. The others? How do people react to these grand new strategy announcements which happen every 2 years? Most people down the line.
They usually find how things will block them.
What is that? What is that? They will find things that will?
How it blocks them from achieving it.
Okay, so that they get focused on the blockage element. The others, any other reactions?
This is just a PowerPoint.
You know what? Believe me, most people down the line by now, they've lived through so many of these strategy announcements. The belief is this too shall pass. So basically, you wait it out long enough and these buggers must have gone for an offside. They've come back and announced something. Soon they'll forget about it. So basically, life will go on as usual. This too shall pass. People down the line are just waiting it out. And amazingly enough, I don't know how much you've seen it, but the strategy becomes the 12th player in the team. It is who is supposed to do it. So the biggest challenge really is to break through that gravity and get people to take charge of executing the strategy and not simply wait for mandates. And you notice, so participative is waiting for mandates. Tell me what to do and I'll do it. A great foot soldier. Passive, do the minimum necessary. By the way, you must have also, all of you must have experienced those people in any team, right? Who have mastered the fine art of survival. So what is the minimum needed to be done in order to survive here? That is passive, right? Even speaking up is a commitment. So it's best to remain silent. So later on you can say, but I never agree. I'm sure you've heard that too very often. By the way, you must have seen a lot of cultures. There is something called public agreement and private disagreement. Have you experienced that, guys? Public agreement and private disagreement?
Many times. That is very common in a board meeting or whatever the discussion is happening. Everyone will say yes, yes. But then they will say, you know, my personal view is this won't, this or this will have a problem.
Yeah. Incidentally, I've seen that happen to new strategies very often. There are a number of these silent assassins. The trouble is they won't speak up, but the whole assumption is in any case, you wait it out. So that's passive. Detractive, of course, is the focus is why it can't be done rather than how it can be done. But I'm sure in every team and organization, you must have seen there are some people who are not participative but contribute, who will step forward to do what they can. So when there is a problem, there are some people who will come forward and try and find a solution regardless of their role, regardless of the so-called compartment they live in. Because they are responding to the organization's need, not simply to the role. I'm sure you have such people that you know of, in fact, in your team where such people are. Those are the people you will turn to in times of crisis. You know that they are dependable. That those are the guys who step forward. But what we need with executing a new strategy is contributive and generative attitudes. So who are treating this strategy as an opportunity and not as a problem? In fact, creating opportunities. How does one do that? This is very often the heart of the starting. This is actually the starting point, if I urge. Is how do you get people to engage with the strategy in a manner that they start solving for it rather than wait it out, in which case it's an obstacle in any case. They become the gravity. So how does one mobilize this? It is I'm sure a key question in all of your minds, and one of you had raised it right in the beginning. So people engagement becomes the mindset gravity. And by the way, the one part which is core, which pulls people down, is in a lot of our organizations today, success equals not failing. Now think about it. Success, in order to succeed, I mustn't fail. So therefore, I take on only those kind of goals which I can succeed with. I take on those kind of targets I can succeed with. I handle those kind of problems I know how to solve. You can imagine, right? So this is the ultimate comfort zone. So have you found this? That success equals not failing. What does it do? Most people react to a new strategy in a play safe way. So play it safe, right? So do what you can. In fact, become overcautious, if anything. And what does the overcaution lead to? Waiting for mandates. And that's one. And the second thing which it leads to is, I'm sure in the time of goal setting, you must have experienced it a lot. So the greatest artists in goal setting are people who know how to under-promise and overachieve. I'm sure you must have experienced this in goal setting exercises, under-promise and overachieve. It's an art form by now, right? So basically, how do you bring down the goal to a point where you already know how to do it, and then you outscore it and become a winner? Whereas a new strategy is posing a new challenge, which is outside the comfort zone. Now, what does that mean? That is where somebody has mentioned to you, they see blockages, because now the chances of failing are high. And so people become extra cautious, if anything. So here is where what we found is that this calls for a fundamental re-examination. How do you now engage people such that they're looking forward to this with a sense of opportunity, with the need to experiment, rather than the assumption of sticking to what you know? So what have you experienced, guys? I would love to know your experience here. Of where have you seen people engagement with problems and challenges? So the same question I asked you earlier, how have you experienced people? So in your areas, wherever you have seen a new strategy being rolled out, where do you find most of the people are? Most of the time, not everybody all the time, there will be exceptions. Along this X chart, as we call it, where do you find most people?
Largely participative or passive sort of.
Mm-hmm. So that's Atul's perspective. The others, please.
Yeah, largely passive.
Mm-hmm. And how does that passiveness show up?
Usually the feedback would be, it's a good thought. We need to discuss more. We need to have more plans. And it gets diluted. That's how it goes on.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah. Anybody else? Let's discuss it.
I think it's mostly passive, in the sense you're waiting for, you know, wind direction to set, to do something, or at the best it's participative or contributory, where you know people are saying, okay, you know, we'll go along as long as we have to go along. So as such, it's a very, I would say, in that sense, still, though it's participative or contributory, it still says passive in its own, in its spirit, you know. So I think it doesn't get into, you know, where people are actually contributing or it's actually participating in the process. So I think that's predominantly what I've seen. Because moment you get into, you don't want to be seen that you're in a directive environment. So from management side, so I think that doesn't happen obviously, but it happens in a very under the current kind of a thing. You know, boss is given this idea, great idea. But generative is one space where people are scared to enter because you get questioned, you know, immediately. Yeah. And
I mean, it's almost like inviting trouble, right?
Trouble. Yeah. Asking for trouble. Yeah.
So go on. I'd love to hear other people's experiences in your world. How have you experienced it?
Actually, one more thing that happens in this map is, you know, you talk about this alignment initiative part. A lot of times, you know, this openness, alignment, and initiative, they don't take place because these are probably not three different things, but they all need to be in place, you know. So invariably, they might be, may not be alignment between two functions kind of things, yeah. You know, right? Or some people may not be very open. And there might be just one guy trying to take initiative and others are saying, he's going to get credit. So I feel those kind of politics or games also take place. But invariably, I feel, you know, it's probably the management's responsibility to set the, you know, sort of alignment as well as openness and initiative through their own action, which normally doesn't happen. You know, in fact, they tend to get teams into confrontative or competitive mode, and which is seen as, you know, which will lead to more ideas, you know. And I feel that's probably where things start to fail for the team because that confuses them, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. If you notice, the one guiding principle we've seen work very wonderfully is, you know, how do we set priorities? Is it function forward or purpose back? If the and how does senior leadership practice that in the sense of that any decision making is done purpose back or aspiration back as opposed to function forward. So what is good for the function versus what's good for the purpose? When the leadership team and the next three levels rally around this principle, it can be one tiebreaker, which will ensure alignment. But it takes quite a lot of engagement to actually make it an anchor point. Absolutely. So that's a great perspective. Anybody else would like to share?
Yeah, as long as my neck is not over there and I'm not going to be accountable, I might as well be passive and participative and show my participation.
Absolutely.
But if I were to generate certain things and try to suggest certain ideas, my neck is going to be there. So it all depends on which position you are into.
Yeah. You know, as you were sharing, I'm reminded of a very interesting experience, a very, very powerful experience we went through once with the team. This was a financial services business as a part of a large group. You know, they were growing very minimally year on year when the industry was actually growing rapidly. So when this large group, all the leaders had collected together, you know, to diagnose why are we not growing, everybody started saying, you know, we are actually a very risk averse. So everybody nodded their heads. Yeah, we are very risk averse. And I'm sure, guys, you must have experienced this where everybody's nodding their heads and saying, we are very risk averse. Because when people say we, fascinatingly, nobody means me. Everybody believes these other guys are risk averse, actually. Whereas for this person who was leading this financial services team, what struck him was, hey, it's not we, it's me. I am risk averse. How come we are not growing in a growing industry? So that flipped him, but he first acknowledged it and then came back and engaged his team. Basically, they got into what they called a dream meetings. The idea was to make them generative. The dream meetings was, so how do we now return growth? So at the end of 2 days of dream meeting, they took on the challenge of doubling next year. You know, we're doubling next year, by the way, reverse hype can also happen. So people get, wow, man, we'll recover next year till the gravity started to settle. And somebody said, you know, all this is sounding very nice here, sitting here in an offsite, but what are we going to tell the board? Are we going to tell them that we'll double next year? What if we don't achieve it? Besides, we'll appear foolish, but we won't make our incentives in any case. Everybody said, yeah, that's a fact. You know, actually, yes, that's true. Now, all this noise started and one guy came up with a very bright idea. You know, I have an idea. What's the idea? You know what? Between us, we'll aim for 2xing next year, but to the board, we promised 10%. That's guys, have you heard this?
Yeah.
This kind of a tie-breaking idea. Have you heard this? Sounds familiar, this conversation?
Completely.
By the way, if you think they had gone after 10%, where would they have reached at the end of the year? It becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. They would have done 115% and we've beaten the goal, clapped themselves on the back. But for this person who was leading it, it struck him that, you know, he cannot allow this to happen. The point that you were making, it was a matter of him personally burning the bridge, putting his credibility on the line. If we will double next year, he promised that to the board. We'll figure it out. I don't have an answer. Now, that takes guts, right? To actually take on a challenge, not having the answer, but with the confidence that we'll figure out how. But that's where orbit shifts begin. That's where new strategies begin, when people take on those kind of challenges. By the way, at the end of the year, they didn't quite double, but they came to 85% of that goal. So did they fail? Not really. They had achieved amazing progress. In fact, year on year, they started working challenge back and not index next year based on last year. The next 4 years, believe me, they quadrupled. But what fundamentally changed was the burning the bridge personally. By the way, all his branch managers, they went to the public and in newspapers announced that they were going to double next year. The objective was to burn the bridge publicly. So there is no going back from now. There's only a way forward. Now, and how they redefined it themselves, I must tell you this, is, you know, who cares about piddly incentives? I mean, after all, if we managed to double in our markets, our employability has gone up. That's what matters. So really, that's one example of a team becoming truly generative. But there are multiple examples like these. I must share with you another. It's not waiting for mandates. For example, with one plant, the strategy was to double productivity without any additional resources. Double the productivity of the plant without additional resources. Now, classically, what happens is everybody's waiting for some grand strategy to come from the top. But the objective was, how do we change people's engagement, right? So everybody got involved, the top three layers of leadership. What are we going to 2x in our space today? It's not waiting for the 2x strategy, but what can you 2x today? Believe me, everybody took on a 2xing challenge within their space. One team took on the challenge of 2xing the throughput. Another team took on the challenge of 2xing the lifetime of a tool, the productivity of a process, all across. What were people doing that took charge? That question is not to wait for mandate, but to 2x what I can in my space today. In fact, I'd urge you to think that the biggest challenge is any engaged people is to engage them with the trajectory of the strategy and get everybody to connect with it right from day one. How can they accomplish that strategy within their sphere of influence? That can be an amazing unleashing force. Then the purpose is truly achieved. The purpose of the new strategy was to mobilize a new direction first. And then in the chase of it, we will achieve, in fact, the new strategy, but more importantly, we will re-energize the organization in a new way. So this, I hope, is giving you some illustration. I'd love to hear from your experiences. Where have you seen this move happen? Positively. Where some people took charge. I'd love to hear that also from you. I've shared two. Would love to hear you, from your perspective, where have you seen that happen? Where some people actually took charge and didn't wait for mandates. Or have you seen some people trying to take charge but being experiencing blockages? Guys, please just think aloud with me.
Yeah, Rajiv, one I can share. Yeah. The second scenario which you mentioned. You know, in our organization, we were trying to build a new process which there is an industry proof saying it will improve the efficiency.
Mm-hmm.
However, it involves all the leaders to spend more time, right? So everyone wants more efficiency, but the time required to spend to make that efficiency build into the system was significant. But you know, it kind of went in more of participative, passive way, and it died down. So that's one example where you know, somebody was trying to do something and it just died down over a period of time.
Yeah, actually, you must have seen that very often the way people even attempt these challenges is spare people in spare time. Yeah, so it's like, you know, I was very frightened when I heard about this 3x strategy from one company. I was talking to one team and they were saying, you know, Rajiv, we are meeting every Friday for 2 hours. Imagine every Friday for 2 hours and we want to create history. That's spare time. We are hardly giving it the engagement it needs to genuinely make it happen. It may not need more time, but it surely needs bursts of time. 1 or 2 dedicated days at a time so that the kind of energy needed to make the progress is there. So what I do, what has also worked for us is getting people into what we call orbit shift workouts for 1 or 2 days so that there is enough momentum achieved at a shot rather than allowing it to get distributed. You know, this 2 hours a week is a orbit maintaining continuous improvement kind of a mental model.
Yeah. So Raju, one more I wanted to quickly share you know, there our organization is in multiple locations. So, you know, one location, if they happen to do something innovative, you know, it kind of gets into a politics where, you know, people say they have more time, they are less loaded, so they can do more innovation. And, you know, probably you should reduce the load for us if we have to do more innovation. So it kind of goes in that direction. So people are now a little more being very careful to do something innovative because they'll be told you are less loaded now.
So as a result, they'll invite even more challenges, is it?
Right.
I'm sure. Yeah. So you notice what this is talking about is even what they have done so far is in spite of the culture. It's not because of it. Because if it was because of it, then this question should be coming up. In fact, this should be the expectation. Because there are some people, right? There are 10% people in any organization who are in spite of the culture, either generative or detractive. So those people, when they do it, the question is, how does the organization mainstream that behavior such that it is inspiring more people to do it rather than getting more problems to them?
Right, yeah.
So how
that's a good thought.
Floor is a very critical question. So in that New York Life example that I was sharing with you, finally it became a book of lighthouses where all these people's stories became legacy. And that was used to build more and more and more rather than invite more problems to them. It build even more people who have the capacity to do it.
Right, yeah.
So what people are, the value is really in how to be like them rather than give them more problems. So guys, at the core of it, everything that I shared with you, the starting point of engaging people, you know, getting people to take charge, etc., where does it begin? What we call an orbit shift dialogue. You know, imagine like getting people into an orbit shift dialogue so that they are not engaging with it in the old way, the new strategy. So how do we get the strategy into every team across the organization, to every function, and engage them with an orbit shifting dialogue and not just simply a tinkering day-to-day discussion, a business as usual discussion. So here what you have are the 5-6 key pointers. How do you get people to think about is not about fixing the problem, but eliminating the problem. And those are the kind of questions they start to think in. Not improve, but transform. Not gap to target, but gap to aspiration. Because everybody has aspiration. The trouble is that they've now learned, though they've gotten dormant. Not just meeting, but beating benchmarks. So when this kind of a dialogue starts, and this has to start with a lot of examples where people begin to see that what this strategy is talking about, actually across industries, people have done it. But and not just within our industry, it's not about best practices. Creating shifting reference points of what is possible. That's the inspiration piece. But then follow it up with getting them to consciously ask themselves, where is there an opportunity to not just fix but eliminate, not improve but transform? You know, for example, a finance team of a major organization took on this challenge. They were handling the global accounts of their organization, and I asked them, so what's the biggest problem? You know, quarterly reconciliation. Sounds strange. This is a very well-known, very respected organization, guys. They were taking 3 weeks every quarter. That's the most painful part. From fixing to eliminate the problem became a question in the orbit shift dialogue. Believe me, now the reconciliation happens online every day. So the starting, they themselves solved it. There was no magic we were doing. It's a matter of more getting them into that question. And these are, I'm just going to end, in the end, just share with you one very fascinating example of where Orbit Shift actually started. The strategy began in one firm but finished in another. You might wonder, how is that possible? Somehow most of my examples have become finance today, but never mind, this is one more back end. So you've heard of Lehman Brothers, right? Before the crisis. So they had a back-end operation in India, and which was doing all the process management back-end. But they were not happy being back-end. They wanted to actually play a front-end impact, which all back-end firms want to do. They took on the challenge that we won't merely play back-end, we'll create a front-end impact, we'll create new value for the organization. So all that happened. They were energized, they took charge, but after that, within a year of that is when the crisis happened and the organization finished, as you all know. You know, amazingly enough, but this mission didn't complete. They had taken such charge of it that the mission got only paused. I got a call back from them after a year saying, you know what, we started in Lehman Brothers, we'll finish in Nomura. They were now, the Nomura had bought over this part of Lehman Brothers. So they were now, the parent was Japanese now and not American. But the challenge of transforming value creation, they took it on and they completed it. They became the center of excellence for Nomura worldwide in 20 areas which they had chosen in Lehman Brothers. Amazing, isn't it? I mean, that to me is a role model of not gap to target, but gap to aspiration. And once you take in charge, it doesn't matter what the context, you find a way to solve for it. And not just accept, oh, you know, the situation is different now, how can we do it here? Would have been the classic answer. But in this case, the encouraging part was that they did not let that happen. So engaging teams in an orbit shifting dialogue deliberately, which breaks boundaries, is the start point really of getting people to take charge. I'm skipping this last example and really coming to the heart of it. So what have we really talked about? Essentially, to transform the pace and impact of a new strategy, what I'm urging us to do is to deliberately identify and lock the gravity. Because just by a rara or an announcement won't do it, because people are living with that gravity. That's the reality. You throw the apple, it comes right back. We need to deal with it head on. What is that gravity now? Is it customer and channel engagement? I would urge that we need to uncover those boxes, those pipes, which will take the strategy in the old way deliberately in terms of business models, the way we engage with customers, channel we talked about, our cultural mental models, which lead us into repair versus redesign, and which may be leading to success equals not failing. So people are kind of playing it cautiously, playing safe. Where are these? And unless we deal with them head on, you should expect the strategy to settle at the lowest common denominator. But this can happen. I've shared with you lots of examples, I mean, where we've seen people do it amazingly. And my hope is more of you will take it on and make it happen. But before that, before we close, final observations from you. So this is our summary. Do share with me, when you look at your organization, which of these are the gravity centers for you that you sense, as a quick reflection?
So Rajiv, this is Unmesh again. Yeah. So couple of things I've seen happening, you know, one is, you know, we assume organization is like one kind, whereas there are different kinds of organizations. in different phases of evolution, maturity, etc. And I think at each of their life stage, they have a different challenge to handle. You know, at some point, it's about the idea. Some point, it's about the reaching the scale. At some point, it's about, you know, operational efficiency or whatever, you know. And to me, I feel they get into rabbit hole of each of these at that stage and forget the rest. You know, a startup is more worried about, you know, getting the idea out rather than thinking of cost or efficiency and scale, etc. So to me, I feel that's something I haven't found an answer in terms of whether they can break those barriers. But that's what happens. Now, the question is, people talk about, you know, intrapreneurship and entrepreneurship, all that. I think the organizational cultures are a huge gravities, you know, and leadership. Yeah. To a large extent, you know, I think they just pull the whole thing in a certain direction, no matter what the rhetoric says and what they publicly say. And I feel that's where there's a lot of gap, you know. I mean, I would put squarely on the leadership and the organizational culture side, why things happen and how things happen.
Just to build further, the real cultural mental model, as you're saying, is the leadership. Can I urge guys, one big gravity really is how we review business as usual projects versus new strategic challenges. Imagine the closest I can get to it, share with you, you know, imagine how, if you were to review an innovation challenge, the way we review a business as usual goal, it would kill it fundamentally. Think about it. What is a usual review? It is actually the purpose of the review is identify the gaps and create a pressurized plugging plan. Whereas, imagine any of these kind of challenges that we've talked about today, a review of that kind of a challenge would be full of unsolved problems. Where the purpose is not a pressurized plugging plan, but actually co-creating how to solve for this. And nobody, including the reviewer, actually has an answer. So the fundamental challenge there is to how do we change how we review progress? We cannot review these new strategic challenges the way we review business as usual projects. So that is squarely where the leadership challenge is. Thanks, Unmesh. Inviting the others also.
Pleasure.
To do share your where are you sensing gravity centers in your experience, in your organization, where you are seeing new strategy at play, or we are trying to execute a new strategy?
Yeah, a few thoughts, Rajiv. One is, I think, on the cultural basis, because as a company which is, you know, 30, 40 years old, there is certain culture and the cultural gravity of it, pulling people in a different direction. How can a person at the front line can come up with a big idea? That's a cultural barrier for people to break through. So that's one of the things which commonly seen nowadays. Especially given that information is so widely available today, anybody can actually become generative. So that is one gravity which is visible. And the other part is, again, I think we kind of covered, which is organizational gravity, where people have to jump out of their comfort zone and do. That is, again, a challenge. When people, as you rightly put, success is equal to not failing. That model stays there. So that is the second gravity I kind of witness in many occasions.
Surely.
Rajiv, actually, this is Reshmi. Yeah. So there are two gravities that I have seen in the organizations. One, building on to the cultural point, that and there is also a fear of speaking up. And often what happens within the organizational gravity, when you're sitting with your middle layer or your junior layer, often they don't want to speak up because either the heads of the divisions are sitting there, especially with business as usual initiatives, So there's a fear of speaking up and accepting because you don't want to, you know, offend your boss sitting there who probably doesn't want to accept it. That's one. And the second of that is very, and when there is a new strategic initiative which has a very different goal, often people in the organization want their business as usual problems to be solved through that. So there is a conflict that there's a new strategic initiative, which probably could be a new solution that you're trying to implement. The objective of it is very different. The goal of strategic goal is different, but you're trying to solve your problems and you would only get engaged if your problems are getting solved. So these two I've often come across.
Okay. Yes, please, the others. So actually, you notice the challenges, what we are talking about is how do we take these challenges proactively and upfront. I would think at the time of rolling out the strategy, the rollout roadmap has to engage both the gravity and the strategy in a seamless roadmap, and deliberately take it head on. So before we close, any last queries, contributions, please do share.
To me, the whole thing seems to be more in terms of how do we create that cultural aspect in the organization where people are free to challenge the current mental models, basically. And you rightly mentioned about in terms of saying that with that there are boxes. How do we identify those boxes? Because it's good to always talk about it. It's a very buzzword in terms of out of the box thinking and those things. I mean, but then, as you rightly mentioned, it's more important in terms of what boxes have already been created, and do we look something beyond those boxes, those mental models basically which are already there? But do the organization create that kind of an ecosystem where people are able to speak freely and voice their opinion, just like my past speaker was trying to tell, saying that most of the time people are afraid or apprehensive in terms of, in case they are voicing out, their bosses would say, oh, this the idea is not going to work, and they will directly come back and say, why did you have to put this up, basically. So those are certain areas where if that kind of an ecosystem is getting created in an organization, it will work wonders. And then all your models related to gravity, which includes the repair versus the redesign part of it and success and not failing, I think that will be given a shot over there.
No doubt. I mean, so you notice the engagement, the center of the X was openness. Absolutely, yeah. That is the backbone. It is the capacity to openly recognize, acknowledge, and challenge these mental models.
That's true.
For example, in the New York Life case, the question was, what is our fear here? 150-year-old firm. How can we challenge them? I mean, they know it all. So the question was, but to deliberately question that in the context of the market and not be subservient to that extent, but constructively challenge. And really, we found at the end of the road that those guys were actually open to it. They weren't contesting it at all.
And the part is basically at the leadership level, how do we ensure that with that each leader are thinking through not just in terms of business as usual problems, but at the same time, something which can be a sort of a disruptive and doesn't have to be today or tomorrow, but maybe 4 years down the line, 5 years down. How does he incubate that thing and not be going on the similar lines as to what business as usual? If that happens, then it's a game on. Then you know that you are thinking long term. It's not just about trying to solve problems which are current problems.
Absolutely.
Because I've seen in my previous organizations where this kind of approach is there, where leaderships are challenged at the leadership level, they are challenged in terms of saying that with that. Think about something when you talk about goals or the promise statements which comes through, what is going to happen, something which you are going to do something 3 years down the line and not just today, but start building on it. And that's where it becomes much more progressive, and then you don't have a target, specific target for it. But at the same time, that ecosystem is getting created over there.
Actually, as a cultural change, Marikos created something very pioneering a few years ago. which was that the way they redefined goals.
Yeah.
Basically, they redefined goals into two tracks. One track is business as usual, goals for next year. Second track became, what will you prototype next year?
That's true.
Basically, a new area, a new opportunity where you will take it to a prototype point, that became a part and parcel of the goals. Essentially, so everybody had the space to experiment. In fact, right. That was the expectation. Harsh Mariwala's first question was, what will you prototype next year? And then the business as usual goal. So you can imagine, right, that this was across all functions, sales, marketing, R&D, HR, supply chain, everywhere. Everybody had two goals, business as usual plus prototype challenge. So you can imagine, even if 20% of these prototypes succeed, it creates an arsenal for next year. And when that is the way we are thinking, then a new strategy comes along, it becomes an opportunity. Because if everybody enjoys experimentation, the strategy presents opportunity, it doesn't create a problem then. People see it as an opportunity and not see it as a problem.
That's true. That's true. And the acceptability level also, the quotient goes up basically.
Absolutely. So guys, any final thoughts before we call it a day today?
Thanks, Rajiv.
Thank you.
Always energizing, inspiring as usual.
Thanks, Rajiv. It has been an insightful session. Thank you.
Before we close out, we take a quick photo, everyone. Before we close out, we'll take a quick photo, everyone. So, Rajiv, you can stop sharing your screen and I can request everyone to please switch on their videos, fix your hair so that we can take a quick photo. Gallery view, please, Kanika.
Yes.
Give everyone a minute or so. And Akash, yes, for the recording, sorry if it's been answered already, but for the recording, we will be uploading all the recordings on our website. Kanika, I can't see a gallery view still. Huh? Maybe my mistake, sorry. Oh, there you go. Perfect. Sorry to keep everyone waiting. So, okay, brilliant. 1, 2, 3, breakthrough. No, that doesn't work. Sorry. 1, 2, 3, gravity.
We can't be wishing for it for sure.
Perfect. I've got the photo. Thank you so much, everyone. Thanks for your time. Thanks for attending.
Thank you. All the best.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.